It's my great pleasure to introduce IAS lecture speaker today. So we have two in a row. Professor Seth Darst is currently a Jack Fishman Professor of Molecular Biophysics at Rockefeller University. Darst actually got his bachelor's degree from the Colorado Boulder, and then he did his PhD degrees in Stanford University, and at that time he was a chemical engineer. I asked Saturday if he has been working on the transcription. So I started his work on the transcription, especially the structure-based basis of the transcription when he was a postdoc with Roger Comberg at Stanford University's, where he and Roger has been working on this using an electron microscope to look at the structure of the RNA primaries for transcription. After that, he joined the faculty at the Rockefeller University in 1992. And then ever since, he stayed in Rockefeller University. And then the SARS research is mostly focused on the structural basis of the transcription. By studying the enzymes involved in this process. And I think the SAS has been awarded in the numerous awards, including the Aaron Hershey Charitable Trust Career Scientist, a Pew Scholar in the Biomedical Science. And in 2008, he was elected to the U.S. National Academy of Science. And I think today, SAS is going to tell us about the structural studies of the transcription, going from the electron microscope to X-ray crystallography, back to the electron microscope. Okay, without further ado, let's welcome Seth.
Okay, thanks a lot, Zhuhui. And it's been great visiting Hong Kong, and I hope we can come back soon. So like Zhuhui said, I started out as a chemical engineer, and I did my PhD at Stanford in chemical engineering, and that was a very fortuitous but fortunate choice because the department at Stanford is very science related. Not there's a weighting between science and engineering. And by the time I finished, I realized I was more interested in the science part than the engineering part. And so also very fortuitously, I ended up in Roger Kornberg's lab and so developed an interest in transcription. And at that time, for both Roger and myself, it seemed an impossible pie in the sky that we would ever be able to use X-ray crystallography to study RNA polymerase, this large macromolecular machine. So at the time, we used electron microscopy to get, at the time, the only structural information that was available on RNA polymerase, so the central enzyme of the transcription process. And when I went to Rockefeller in 92, it was to do more EM, basically. But we also started dabbling in crystallography, and lo and behold, we got crystallography to work, as I'll describe here. And it soon became evident that crystallography was the way to go. And so since then, I've turned less and less into an EM person and more into an X-ray crystallographer. And as many of you are probably well aware, now in the last 2 years or so, this can't really be overstated. There's really a revolution in structural biology, not just in structural biology of transcription, but all structural biology, where electron microscopy has now become a competitor with X-ray crystallography and is even probably going to be better than X-ray crystallography for many types of problems. And so what I'll describe at the very end is how we're now getting into the new, more modern technology of electron microscopy, why it's become so powerful, and how we hope to use it to study transcription to solve problems that we haven't been able to solve with X-ray crystallography. So transcription is sort of the central point of the central dogma between replication and translation. It's linked to replication by the DNA template, and it's linked to translation by the RNA product. And the central enzyme of transcription is this RNA polymerase enzyme. So the bacterial enzyme is 5 subunits and has a molecular weight of about 400 kilodaltons. The eukaryotic enzymes have 12 to 15 subunits and have molecular weights more like 500 kilodaltons. But the central enzyme, part of the enzyme, is very highly conserved. And what diverges between bacteria and eukaryotes is the regulation and the sort of bells and whistles. So this is one of my favorite old micrographs of the transcription process. The line that you see here is the DNA template. And the little black dots on the line are the RNA polymerase molecules themselves. They're actually moving from the lower right to the upper left. And you can see as they're moving, they're making a longer and longer chain of the product of this reaction, which is an RNA strand that has a sequence complementary to one strand of the DNA, which is called the template DNA strand. And the other thing I like about this picture is that it illustrates how highly regulated this process is. It's probably the, especially in bacteria, this is the central point of regulation for gene expression. And you see that all the molecules start in the same place. This is the promoter. They all finish in the same place. This is the terminator. The other thing I'd like to point out here is that this, I don't even remember if this is an image of a eukaryotic transcription unit or a prokaryotic one. If it's eukaryotic, these things assembling on the RNA are spliceosomes, RNA processing factors. If it's bacterial, these are ribosomes, because translation and transcription can happen at the same time. But in either case, whether this is eukaryotic or prokaryotic, this is definitely a ribosomal RNA gene, because in no other gene in the cell are the RNA polymerase molecules packed in this sort of bumper-to-bumper traffic. And on average, in a bacterial cell, a gene will have less than one RNA polymerase molecule on it at a time. So this is actually a very special situation. So especially work at studying the bacterial system from Mike Chamberlain and Peter von Hippel and many other researchers since the 60s, we think of the way the RNA polymerase enzyme works as a transcription cycle, which we divide into distinct, at least schematically or conceptually, into distinct biochemical steps. So in this cycle, the enzyme binds the DNA template. It locates specific sequences called the promoter. Once the promoter is located, one way or the other, the enzyme creates what we call the transcription bubble. So a region of the DNA template is strand separated or melted to create single-stranded template strand that the enzyme loads into the active site, and it will use that to template the sequence of the RNA. So once this is accomplished in the presence of substrate, the enzyme can begin making RNA. And actually, all of the multi-subunit cellular RNA polymerases, be they bacterial, archaebacterial, eukaryotic, they don't just happily start making RNA and move on their way. They sit at the promoter making short RNA products that are constantly released. This is called abortive cycling or abortive initiation. Only once in a while does the enzyme escape from this sort of futile cycle in a step called promoter clearance, where the enzyme physically moves from the promoter. The transcription bubble moves with the enzyme, and then it enters this highly processive elongation phase. And this complex we call the ternary elongation complex, or TEC, because it contains DNA template, RNA enzyme, RNA polymerase enzyme, and RNA product, so three components. And this is highly processive and can move along the DNA template, synthesizing an RNA chain without dissociating. Unless it runs off the end of the template, or it transcribes specific sequences called terminators that get transcribed into the RNA product, that encode secondary structures that tell the RNA polymerase to stop and then eventually release the DNA template and the RNA product, and then this cycle can begin again. There can also be factor-dependent termination, where there are regulatory factors that induce termination on their own. So all the multi-subunit cellular polymerases have a key feature of this transcription cycle in that the core enzyme that I described earlier, the 5-subunit bacterial enzyme that's 400 kilodaltons, is completely competent to make the RNA product from the DNA template, but it's unable to go through these initiation steps without even additional protein subunits. So for the eukaryotic enzymes, these initiation-specific factors are dozens of them that assemble with the RNA polymerase to facilitate promoter-specific initiation, and they can make up more mass than the polymerase itself. But in the bacterial system, there's a single polypeptide, and that's called the sigma factor. So sigma binds the catalytic core, and then we call this complex the hollow enzyme. The hollow enzyme is what locates promoters, melts the DNA, goes through abortive cycling. Once the enzyme clears the promoter and physically moves away from the promoter, this initiation-specific subunit actually dissociates. And it can find another core enzyme and go through this initiation process. And then the core enzyme goes on to finish the elongation process. And so this really points out one main reason that we sort of focus on the bacterial transcription system rather than the eukaryotic system. Because especially the regulatory processes, the initiation process itself, while it has to accomplish the same goals in the end, the bacterial system does it in a much more simple way. And so we're much further along, I think, in understanding how the enzyme locates promoters, makes the transcription bubble, and initiates transcription because the eukaryotic system is so complex. So maybe because my background is engineering or something, one of the things that you're really drilled into your head during engineering school is that you're presented with a problem, you need to solve this problem. The first thing you do is draw a picture, get a picture of the thing so that you can understand what's going on. So what we really seek to do is to get structural snapshots of all the different stages of the transcription cycle. So the core enzyme, the hollow enzyme, complexes with promoters, structures of sigma with regulatory proteins, elongation complexes, and so on and so forth. And you can see on this picture, which is sort of outdated, that we and other groups, not just us, have made a lot of progress in sort of filling in these pictures. But what I'd like to do, so now everybody knows like these high-resolution structures exist, and what I'd like to do is step back and talk about how, like I said, how it got started in Roger's lab when I was a postdoc, how we used EM to get some of the initial information and how that information compares with what we know now, and then how things have progressed over the years. So initially in Roger's lab, because we, like I said, we always thought it was sort of would be impossible to get three-dimensional crystals that diffracted X-rays well enough to solve the structure of such a large macromolecular machine. So at the time, it wasn't precedented. Now we have high-resolution structures of the ribosome, so obviously we were wrong. But at the time, we thought electron microscopy was the way to go. And it was still, the technology of electron microscopy wasn't at a state where you could determine structures from single particles of a complex like RNA polymerase. It's too small. And so we needed to grow crystals. It's a method called electron crystallography, where the principles with electron crystallography and X-ray crystallography are very similar because you've assembled a crystal, you achieve averaging very easily over the uniquely placed molecules within the crystal using Fourier transform theory. So this was clear that we had to do that, but because of the properties of the electron microscope, the difference between electrons and X-rays, the crystals had to be very, very thin, and preferably they have to be one layer thick. And so initial idea was a way to grow what we call two-dimensional crystals. And the way that was done was at an air-water interface that had a lipid monolayer. So the lipids would orient towards the air, the hydrophobic air. The hydrophilic head groups of the lipid would orient towards the aqueous solution. And then Roger's idea was to link specific ligands onto the head groups of the ligands, say you have an ATP binding protein, you could link an ATP analog to the head group of the lipids. The protein in solution, which doesn't need to be at very high concentration, can get concentrated at this interface by specific binding to the ligand. And if you calculate if you take the thickness of the protein layer and the volume that the protein occupies here, you can achieve extremely high concentrations of protein just in this layer that can be like 1,000 or 1,500 mg per mil easily. And then because it's a lipid monolayer and we use fluid lipids at room temperature, it still can diffuse, so there's lateral motion going on. So the combination of diffusion and lateral motion and then extremely high concentration of protein restricted to this one layer drives the formation of crystals. And this was Roger's idea. Well, then once the crystals form, they can be transferred to some kind of substrate and then analyzed by electron microscopy. So my contribution to this was we tried for many, many years using various ligands that would bind RNA polymerase like rifampicin or other types of ligands, and we could never get very good results. And my contribution to this was to not use a specific ligand on the head group of the lipid, but to dope the lipid monolayer with charged lipids. So it turns out the surface of RNA polymerase is very, very acidic, so it's negatively charged. This is like all the polymerases are that way. And so what we did is we doped the lipid monolayer with positively charged lipids. The polymerase would get attracted to the surface just by electrostatic interactions, and we were able to get crystals that way. So initially, I worked with Mike Chamberlain, and we got crystals of E. coli RNA polymerase hollow enzyme, and we were able to get a very low-resolution structure. And then later, the work going on in Roger's lab was really focused on eukaryotic polymerase, and especially the yeast transcription system. We were able to get 2D crystals of Saccharomyces cerevisiae RNA polymerase II. And this is a negative stain picture of a region of these crystals. So actually in negative stain, you transfer the crystals onto a substrate, you soak it in a heavy metal solution, the metal sort of fills in around the protein, but it doesn't penetrate inside the protein. So then when you dry it, you end up with a metal layer that has holes in it that are the shape of the protein. So the protein would be the light parts, where the stain is are the dark parts. Because even at this time, cryo-EM was right just beginning. It was like cutting edge technology. It wasn't standard methodology at the time. So from 2D crystals like this, taking many, many images of the crystals at different actually tilt angles, you have to tilt the crystals to get a 3D structure, and putting all this data together, this was the result, about a 16 angstrom or so resolution structure of yeast RNA polymerase II. You may be able to see in these crystals, they look like sort of little butterflies. You can see sort of two. It's because the crystals, one molecule was like this, and then the other one was flipped over. So the interaction with the lipid surface was actually two faces of the polymerase were interacting with the lipid surface. So that means that if we actually had lipids with a specific ligand, they would all be facing the same way, and we would never have gotten these crystals. And actually, if we take one molecule of these crystals, and then we look at the more high-resolution yeast pol II structures that are available now, it's pretty clear how it fits in. This is a yeast pol II structure, and you can see the obvious, you know, similarity. And this is another view of one of those molecules. And obviously you can look at this molecule and you can see all these sort of channels and grooves and things. And this, I want to present this as it's great that we have this low resolution structure. It's the only structure of RNA polymerase that was available at the time. So it was very exciting for everyone. But then, you know, we don't have any information now about like what parts of the molecule correspond to what bumps and grooves. And so it's very easy to look at this and you see these grooves and things, and we hypothesize that strands of nucleic acids were accommodated into these grooves. And it turns out now that we have high-resolution structures and structures of transcription complexes, this is all completely, the structure's not wrong, but the interpretation of where nucleic acid goes and stuff is completely wrong. So it's nice to have low-resolution structural information if you don't have any other information, but you need the higher resolution. It's very difficult to go from a picture like this to making functional predictions without more information. Just a cautionary note. So actually, when I went to Rockefeller, we actually continued to use this technique, and we had a low resolution structure of the E. coli hollow enzyme, so the initiating form, but we wanted to get the form, the core enzyme, the elongating form of the enzyme. And Andrei Polyakov, a postdoc in the lab, and myself, when we tried to set up two-dimensional crystals on the lipid monolayers, and we looked at them in the electron microscope, this is actually what we saw. What happened actually is the lipids formed liposomes. This is a liposome. And then the RNA polymerase, when it crystallizes on the surface, the crystals, instead of being flat, they're curved. They would actually force the lipid into these tubes that have crystals of RNA polymerase around the outside. So they're kind of like barber poles. There's a cylinder of lipid bilayer, and then RNA polymerase molecules crystallize in a helix on the outside. So these helical tubes, now this is not negative stain anymore, this is cryo-EM, because the helical tubes, if you dry them in negative stain, they flatten and then they're more difficult to analyze. But these helical systems are actually really good substrates for cryo-EM. Now this is later, we have a reconstruction, and so we're looking right down the axis of a tube. This is density from the lipids, the cylinder, and then the RNA polymerase molecules bind on the outside and then crystallize it in a helical arrangement. So here's an image of a tube by cryo-EM. And since these are helical crystals, they give a helical diffraction pattern. And people in the cryo-EM field, like Nigel Unwin and many others, have spent many years working out how to turn these kinds of diffraction patterns into three-dimensional structures. So from this, we were able to get a structure of the E. coli core enzyme. And again, this is maybe 15 angstroms, 12 angstrom resolution, something like that. Again, we see this, as we saw previously in the yeast poll too, this what we call now the crab claw. So we knew already the enzyme was like a crab claw with a big open channel in the middle, and we all, you know, obviously we presume this is where the nucleic acids go. Later, we solved a high-resolution structure of the bacterial polymerase, and then even later, we finally solved a higher resolution structure of the E. coli polymerase, and that's what you see a fit into the complex here. And we can see from this fitting of the X-ray structure into the EM density that it doesn't really fit very well. But if you allow it to conformationally relax, this is actually a part of the structure called the clamp domain that we know now can move a lot, kind of like a Pac-Man. And this is turning out to be a very important feature of the RNA polymerase, and the clamp conformation has a lot to do with different functional states of the polymerase. Now, we could even go a little further with these helical crystals. This is actually adding a transcription factor. It's an elongation factor called GRIB. And we can look. This is actually fitting the X-ray structure in. And then there's extra density. The extra densities correspond here and here to parts of the polymerase that are present in E. coli and not in thermos, which is where the X-ray structure was from. But there's another density here, and that's the factor GRIB. And we already had done an X-ray structure of GRIB, so we were able to fit that into the density. And so this was an example of building up a higher order sort of regulatory complex from this low resolution map. And then from the insights gained from this structural organization, we're able to make predictions that were borne out by by mutagenesis and other biochemical studies. But this is sort of the limit of where things got with the EM studies. And let me go through some of the issues. So for electron crystallography, these two-dimensional or these helical crystals, they take a lot less sample than three-dimensional crystals for X-ray crystallography, but they're not any easier to grow than 3D crystals. So it's really a lot of work, and even if you have crystals and you want to look at another state, you have to basically start from scratch. The structural analysis has really severe limitations, so it's because of the technology of the EM, it was very, very difficult to get better than, say, 15 or 12 angstrom resolution, these sort of blobs of density that I'm showing you. And unless you have high-resolution structures to help interpret these low-resolution maps, it's very, very difficult to make progress. And because these are crystals, either 2D or helical, you have something that a lot of X-ray crystallographers, I think, like to ignore or sort of brush under the rug, and that's crystal packing effects. So the packing of the molecules into crystals can induce forces on the molecule that change its conformation. And you need to always be aware when you're looking at crystal structures that it's not just the molecule floating in space that you might see the pictures of. It's in the context of a very tightly packed crystal that can alter its conformation, and the conformation seen in the structure may not actually correspond to the functional state that you think that you're looking at. Another type of EM was coming into its own, particularly through work on the ribosome. And this is called single particle analysis, where it's not even necessary to have crystals. You're able to determine structures, medium resolution structures, without crystals at all, just taking images of single molecules in solution. And this was possible with the RNA polymerase. It's as things get larger, the EM analysis becomes easier. So for instance, the ribosome is a really great substrate for single particle analysis in EM. But the RNA polymerase was actually pretty small, especially at this time. It was very difficult to go beyond medium resolution, and it was very easy to make mistakes that result in artifactual structures. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but in the early 90s, mid 90s, there are actually several RNA polymerase structures from single particle analysis that were published that were just completely, completely wrong. But we did work with a colleague of mine at Scripps, Francisco Asturias, and we did a single particle reconstruction of E. coli core enzyme. And this is actually that reconstruction with the X-ray structure fit into it. And you can see that although the reconstruction is very low resolution, because we have now the X-ray structures to interpret it with, you can see that it's right. So my point is the old technology, EM, is a lot of work, but it's very low payoff because of the low resolution. It's very, very hard to get beyond this sort of medium resolution level. Whereas X-ray crystallography, it's also a lot of work, but if you succeed, it's very high payoff. So obviously we started moving into X-ray crystallography. And what I'd like to do is start with where we started with the crystallography, and that's the core enzyme. And I'd like to make a little, Bob Landick is sitting back there. So this, getting these crystals was a really big deal. And we really owe this to two people. One is Gongyi Zhang, who was the postdoc in the lab who did the tremendous amount of work to get these crystals in the first place, and then to solve the structure from the crystals de novo, which was also a lot of work. But another person involved in this was Bob Landick, and that's because, I don't know if he remembers this, but our lab and many other labs had spent many, many years trying to crystallize E. coli polymerase, and we could never get crystals that were suitable for structure determination. And so actually Gongyi and I were sitting, and Bob happened to be visiting, and we were chatting about this, and we kind of came to the conclusion that we got to start working on E. coli. We got to work on some other bacterial enzyme. And why don't we work on a thermophile? You know, because thermophiles not for everything, but sometimes they, as a rule of thumb, they're more amenable to structural analysis. And Bob piped in and he said, at the University of Wisconsin, where he was from, they have a large fermenter facility, and I think it was Promega had grown a huge, vast vat of thousands of liters of Thermus aquaticus cells to make TAC DNA polymerase, and then for some reason they didn't pay for it, so they had like kilograms of Thermus aquaticus cells sitting in the freezer at Wisconsin, and nobody had paid for it, and they didn't know what to do with it, and Gong Yi and I were like, can we have it? And Bob said, sure. So he sent us this kilogram of Thermus aquaticus cells. And then Gong Yi, we used the E. coli prep on Thermus, so it wasn't really optimized. And Gong Yi, we eventually got pure Thermus aquaticus RNA polymerase, but it was sort of 100 micrograms or so because we hadn't really optimized the prep. And so when we're done with the prep and we saw we got pure enzyme and it wasn't degraded and stuff, and we were pretty happy about that. And I said, well, now let's go back and we need to optimize this prep and get, you know, 100 mgs instead of 100 micrograms. And Gong Yi said, no, this is enough. This is enough to set up a tray. So he set up one tray and it grew the crystals. So that was like switching to the new species was a really good idea. So eventually, we had a lot of technical difficulties in freezing these crystals, so we don't just take the crystals and collect X-ray data because the powerful X-ray beam from the synchrotron will just destroy the crystals before we can collect enough data. So the crystals have to be frozen, called cryocrystallography, and freezing the crystals can be a big obstacle to getting good data. And that was really after we got the crystals and we knew they diffracted. It was many, many months and many synchrotron trips before we were able to figure out how to freeze them. And then this was the result. This is one shot from the X-ray. You can see out here they diffract to not quite 3 angstrom resolution. And so Gong Yi was able to collect heavy metal derivatives using sort of old-fashioned isomorphous replacement and solve the structure. And so here's the result of that. This is Thermus aquaticus core enzyme. Again, you see this crab claw that we knew already. But now, because we have high resolution, we know this one pincer is mostly the large beta prime subunit. The other pincer is mostly the large beta subunit. But parts of beta prime are over here and parts of beta are here, so it's an extremely complicated fold. There's two copies of the alpha subunit. They dimerize outside this main channel, and this part of alpha, the role is probably to dimerize and form a platform that beta and beta prime, to help assemble beta and beta prime. And then this little white subunit omega is here. And we believe from genetic and also structural data that omega is probably a dedicated chaperone for folding of the beta prime subunit. And then in the middle of this big channel between the two pincers, right here is a magnesium ion. So this is the active site. So this is where catalysis takes place. And so what I wanted, here we go. So as this spins around, you'll see lots of sort of grooves and channels, and even then, we could make hypotheses about what these grooves and channels were for, and more or less, we were right. What I want to do right now is sort of, not that. Doing this with my left hand, and I'm sorry. One structural feature you'll see right here, we call this the flap domain. Obviously, it's like a flap sticking out. In the eukaryotic structures, they call it the wall. That's the thing highlighted in yellow right now. Another really distinctive feature of the structure is this helix. We call it the bridge helix because it bridges the top and bottom pincers right through the middle of what we call the active site channel. And another feature of the structure we'll highlight here. These two helices, the clamp helices on this domain that we call the clamp, that we knew already moves up and down like a Pac-Man. Let's talk about elongation. So once we had this structure of the core enzyme, it turned out that already in the literature there was a lot of data on cross-linking and cross-link mapping between the nucleic acids and the RNA polymerase. And then our colleague, who we collaborated with, Arkady Mustayev, generated a whole bunch of other cross-links using a different chemical tricks that he uses. And so we had a very large data set of cross-links between specific positions of the DNA, either the non-template strand in yellow, the template strand in red, or the RNA transcript in orange, and then specific regions or specific residues of the RNA polymerase. And then because we had a high-resolution structure, we could put all these things together and make a model of what the transcribing complex actually looks like. So this would correspond, this is the non-template strand in the transcription bubble, which is held out of the active site channel between two domains of the beta subunit. Buried inside the active site channel is an RNA-DNA hybrid that's either 9 or 10 base pairs, depending on whether it's pre- or post-translocated. And that was already known from biochemical studies. And this was easily accommodated within the structure. And then if we spin this around, this is downstream DNA. And I want to point out that a couple things. Sorry about that. I'm going to use my right hand. One thing I want to point out is that, like this schematic here, the green nucleotide represents the incoming nucleotide substrate. And you can see, if you look from the front, there isn't really any way for the substrate to get into the active site. But if you turn the enzyme and you look down, we call this the secondary channel. Or in Pol II, they call it the funnel. It's a hole here on the side that leads like straight into the active site. So you can see the access to the active site here. So we were fairly certain that the nucleotide substrates, at least the majority of the time, get into the active site through this. It's like a feeding tube for the active site. The other thing I'd like to point out is from the cross-linking data, do it this way. From the cross-linking data, we already were able to propose that the RNA transcript, the hybrid is broken up here by this feature of the structure is called the lid domain. The product of the reaction is single-stranded RNA, so the RNA-DNA hybrid is disrupted. The single-stranded RNA is extruded out this channel between the flap domain and the rest of the enzyme. So we call that the RNA exit channel. There, you can see it better here. Channel here. And now, this was in 2000, and maybe about 5 or 6 or 7 years later, structures of Pol II and also bacterial elongation complexes came out. And all of these things, in terms of the general architecture, were basically correct from Arkady's cross-linking analysis. Now, the other thing that the high-resolution structures in the X-ray crystallography allowed us and others to do is to look at the binding of small molecule inhibitors or ligands. And a really important one, the first one that we focused on was actually rifampicin, or rifamycins, because it's actually a key component of tuberculosis treatment. If you have TB and the TB organism that you're infected with is RIF resistant, you have a much worse prognosis and it takes much longer to get rid of the disease. Just as an aside, at the time rifampicin was discovered, it's actually a natural product from this bacteria. It was discovered in Italy, and at the time there was this movie. It's actually one of the first sort of Godfather type sort of detective gangster movies called Rafifi, and it was extremely popular in Italy, and that's actually where the name rifampicin came from. We rented it and watched it. It's a really good movie, actually. You should watch it. So actually, from the crystals that Gong Yi grew, we were just able to soak in or co-crystallize rifampicin And here you see this is the density. We know the structure of the polymerase, so we can subtract out the density, and then we're left with the density for the rifampicin. You see it here. And what we found wasn't a big surprise, because we already knew where all the rifampicin-resistant mutations were located, but the rifampicin binds in a pocket of the beta subunit, not really at the active site. It's about 15 or 20 angstroms away from the active site. And that structural information combined with some really elegant functional information that we did in collaboration with Arkady Mustayev, that I don't have time to go through, led to this model where it's known that rifampicin binding doesn't interfere with DNA binding. So the DNA is here in gray. You can see from the structural modeling that the RIF doesn't interfere with the DNA. But if you start trying to make an RNA transcript, there's one, two, three nucleotides of RNA, and then it crashes into the rifampicin. So depending on whether you have a monophosphate or a triphosphate at the 5' end of the RNA, you can get a three-mer or a four-mer transcript. And that's complete. You see this better here, one, two, three, maybe four before it crashes into the rifampicin. So we consider the rifampicin sort of like a steric block. It's sitting there just blocking elongation of the RNA past either three or four nucleotides. And that's completely consistent with the biochemistry that we were able to do. So now, 2016, I guess it is now, we view the RNA polymerase as a sort of big molecular machine, right, that's doing all these things all through the transcription cycle, very complicated functions of the enzyme. If we think of the polymerase like a machine, sort of like a car engine, it's going through this complicated combustion cycle. There's many, many ways you can sort of imagine, you can interfere with the function of an engine. And just the same way with the RNA polymerase, there's many, many ways you can interfere with its function. So one of those is rifampicin that I just described. There's actually another really interesting natural product called sorangicin that is completely chemically unrelated to rifampicin, but it binds in exactly the same pocket and functions exactly the same way, but it's completely different chemical. Other groups, Richard Ebright's group and Dmitry Vasilyev's group, studied another inhibitor called streptolitogen that binds here, and we think it affects conformational changes in the bridge helix. Again, Richard Ebright's group and Vasilyev's group studied a series of antibiotics that bind down here. And this is actually the clamp domain, and the hinge of the clamp between the rest of the enzyme is right here. So binding of antibiotics in this region actually interferes with normal clamp movement and interferes with polymerase function. Bob Landick, in collaboration with our group, worked on these sort of CBR compounds that actually bind up here. And we actually, although we have high resolution structures and a lot of biochemical information, it's still not clear how these molecules inhibit polymerase, so we're still working on that. There's more. Tom Steitz's group solved a structure of E. coli polymerase bound to PPGPP, which regulates its function. It actually binds in the back at the interface of omega and the rest of the polymerase. What do I have? Oh, yeah. Richard Ebright's group solved this really interesting structure of another compound that binds near the active site, but distinct from all these other antibiotics. And finally, in unpublished work, we've solved structures of these peptide inhibitors that actually bind in the secondary channel. We think they may interfere with nucleotides getting into the active site, and they also interfere with conformational changes in the active site that are required for catalysis. Now, let's switch from the core enzyme to the initiating form of the enzyme. This is the hollow enzyme. This is a view of the core again, so this sort of crab claw, the beta prime pincer, the beta pincer. So now we're looking at the sigma subunit, which is orange. And so I thought I had this slide in here, but I don't. This core part of the enzyme, you could just as well be looking at, if you focus on this region around the active site magnesium, which is this yellow dot here, you could just as well be looking at archibacterial or eukaryotic RNA polymerases. They're all essentially identical around this region. The differences happen when you move outside, and all the extra subunits that are present in the archibacterial and eukaryotic enzymes are around the outside of the enzyme. But around the active site, they're all essentially identical. So the catalytic function, the very basic functions of the enzyme are conserved. But this feature of now the initiation process, this sigma factor, there's nothing in eukaryotes or archibacteria like sigma. Sigma's bacterial, unique to bacteria. So sigma's actually a bunch of domains, structural domains linked by flexible linkers. We call this domain 2. This is domain 3. It's linked by a hinge. And then there's a long linker that connects to domain 4 that's positioned over here on the polymerase. And one of the things we knew already from cross-linking, but when we saw it in the structure, it really drove home that this long linker between domains 3 and 4 goes in very near the active site and then out. And what we see, if you remember the structures I was showing you earlier, this linker actually is in the path between the channel between the flap domain and the rest of the polymerase, which is the RNA exit channel. So sigma is occupying the RNA exit channel. And so this led to a really cool model that's sort of, as far as I know, is still true today. And that is, as the enzyme initiates and starts making RNA, it makes this RNA-DNA hybrid in the active site here. And as it's elongating RNA, and the RNA has to move along its path here, it has to displace the sigma subunit. And displacement of the sigma subunit gives rise to this process of abortive initiation that I talked about. And also, the RNA is the thing, as the enzyme is making RNA, it's displacing sigma. Once it fills this channel with RNA, sigma dissociates, and then now it knows you have an elongation complex. So it's the binding and then dissociation of sigma sort of built into the whole structure of the complex. Now that we have the hollow enzyme, we want to know what it looks like when it's bound to the promoter. This is actually more recent work. This is the structure from our lab from a Thermus aquaticus RNA polymerase bound to the transcription, the promoter in the transcription bubble. And at about the same time, there was a structure from Tom Steitz's group of E. coli RNA polymerase bound to a transcription bubble. And you can see the obvious analogies here. The promoters in bacteria are characterized by two really core elements, this upstream minus 35 element that always remains double-stranded and is bound to this part of sigma positioned over here, domain 4. And then the minus 10 element that's starts double-stranded, obviously, but then eventually when the enzyme forms the transcription bubble, which is shown here, a lot of the minus 10 element is the first part of the DNA that gets melted. And the really key part of melting, generating, initiating the formation of the transcription bubble is that the sigma subunit here by sequence specifically binds the single strand of DNA here with this sequence that's highly conserved. So we were actually able to see, this is a high resolution structure of just sigma bound to the minus 10 element, and you see that high resolution interaction between parts of the minus 10 element and pieces of sigma. But when we have the proper structure with the whole transcription bubble and the upstream DNA, you can see this conformation change in these two tryptophanes that we never realized until we had a high resolution structure of the whole complex. Now, in addition to these sort of central parts of the transcription cycle, the core, hollow, open complex, and the elongation complex that I talked about, in bacteria, it's estimated there are probably 200 to 300 gene products that regulate the whole transcription cycle. And many of these regulators interact with the polymerase directly and modulate its function. So you're all probably familiar with repressors and activators that act at these stages of the transcription cycle. But actually, there's regulators that interact with all the phases of the transcription cycle. There's regulators that regulate sigma access to the core, regulators for promoter escape, elongation factors, termination factors. I think if there's any opportunity for regulating the enzyme, there's probably some factor in the bacteria that does that function. And another really, so once we have the structures of these sort of stable complexes around the transcription cycle, we want to know how they're regulated. So one is that it's important to look at the regulation per se, but also understanding how these factors regulate the polymerase sort of sheds light on the polymerase function itself. And one thing that we can really take advantage of, especially now that we have high-resolution structures of E. coli RNA polymerase, is the information on interaction of phage, bacteriophage that infect E. coli with the transcription system. And so bacteriophage are viruses that infect bacteria. A lot of the beginnings of molecular biology and sort of the paradigms of molecular biology, the central dogma, replication, transcription, translation, they came from studying phage. And there are a lot of, particularly three bacteriophage, T7, T4, and phage lambda, that infect E. coli, where there's just decades and decades of genetic and biochemical work. But there was never the concomitant high-resolution structural work to understand how these factors interact with the host transcription system and either inhibit it or take it over. In the case of bacteriophage T7, which is a case I'm going to talk about really quickly here, the phages are usually very specific to their host bacteria. They bind to the surface of the bacteria. They inject their genome. And then some phage actually encode their own RNA polymerases. So in the case of T7, the first gene that's transcribed on the phage genome is the T7 RNA polymerase, which is the phage's own RNA polymerase. But at the initial stage of transcription, obviously, there's no RNA polymerase injected with the genome. So that transcription has to happen from the host polymerase. So the phage has ways of, the way that's accomplished is that the first promoters on the phage genome are just very, very strong promoters that are able to successfully compete with the promoters in the genome of the E. coli and get this gene transcribed. Once this first gene is transcribed and the phage has made its own RNA polymerase that does the rest of the transcription program, it basically wants to turn off the host polymerase. So the second gene that's transcribed is actually called GP2, and it's a very potent inhibitor of E. coli RNA polymerase. And so what we knew from many years of study, genetic studies, and actually structural studies of pieces of RNA polymerase, is that we know that GP2 binds to this piece of the polymerase that you see right here. It's called the jaw domain. And from modeling of those structures and other biochemical information, the model for how this worked is that GP2 binds here, facing the active site channel, and it's basically interfering with the loading of DNA into the active site. So GP2 is an inhibitor of the hollow enzyme. If GP2 is bound to the hollow enzyme, then it cannot interact with promoters. If the polymerase is already bound to a promoter, then GP2 can't interact. So the downstream, if you remember, the downstream DNA of the complex is accommodated in this channel. And the model was that GP2 binds here and basically occludes loading of the DNA into the channel. But it turned out that our collaborator, Ramesh, did an experiment where, okay, sorry, I forgot one thing. That's it. Remember I told you this is domain 2 of sigma, this is 3, and then 4 is back on the flap domain. Well, there's a domain 1 that's here. Domain 1 was known to be important for autoregulation and auto-inhibition of sigma functions. So sigma is actually not, although all the promoter-specific recognition goes through the sigma subunit, sigma on its own doesn't bind promoters, and domain 1 is important for that auto-inhibition. The reason is sigma is very good at melting the DNA because of these tryptophanes that I pointed out. You don't want sigma binding to promoters and melting DNA when the polymerase is actually not there. So domain 1 is important for auto-inhibition of sigma function. It's also important for the process of creating the transcription bubble. That's because it was known already from fluorescence studies that from Ebright's group that domain one of sigma sits in the active site and basically blocks access. So we think domain one acts like sort of a gatekeeper and prevents non-specific nucleic acids from getting into the active site. But if the polymerase recognizes a bona fide promoter sequence and goes through the steps of open complex formation, domain one somehow is kicked out of the active site. Then the DNA can load into the active site and transcription can begin. So all the structures previously that contained domain one was disordered. So it's obviously very dynamic. Sometimes it's in the channel, sometimes it's out of the channel. But in this particular crystal form, we were lucky that when we included domain one, it was sitting in the downstream channel where it was predicted to be from the fluorescence studies. And what we were surprised to find is that when we added GP2, GP2 is this green protein, so it's binding here as it's supposed to the jaw domain, but it also binds to domain one. So it makes this sort of three-way protein-protein-protein interaction. And this interaction was not previously known. So actually what GP2 is doing is binding domain one and preventing it from leaving the active site channel so that the DNA can't get in. And that's a really important feature of its function. So in the normal situation, domain one sits in the active site channel. If non-promoter DNA tries to get in here, it can't because domain one is blocking it. But if a proper promoter comes and goes through the steps of promoter initiation, domain one is actually ejected from the active site channel and the promoter DNA can load in the active site. But when GP2 is there, it binds domain one and the promoter binds and tries to get in, but it can't because domain one is being held into the active site. Another case of regulation that probably is more famous is activators that can affect either binding of polymerase to the promoter or what we call isomerization, and that's formation of the transcription bubble. So from studying activators, basically almost always in E. coli or phage activators that infect E. coli, a paradigm for transcription activation is sort of built up, and that paradigm is shown here. The transcription activators, they're almost always homodimeric DNA binding proteins. They bind specific DNA sequences that are upstream of the promoter. And then they, by binding to the DNA, they make specific protein-DNA interactions. And then they also make protein-protein interactions with the polymerase, either with the alpha subunit or with domain 4 of the sigma subunit, as I'll show you in a minute. Or they may interact with both. And by generating these favorable protein-DNA and protein-protein interactions, they stabilize the polymerase on the promoter, and that's how they activate transcription. This is a particular example of a famous activator. It's actually lambda repressor, which is a repressor for some lambda promoters, but is an activator for others. It's this blue dimeric protein. It binds an operator just upstream of a promoter minus 35 element. That's the purple sequence. And by binding here, it juxtaposes with domain 4 of sigma and makes a very small protein-protein interface that I think it's like 5 residues or something like that. But those interactions are enough to tip the balance to favorably stabilize this complex and activate transcription several hundredfold. We've studied, I told you this paradigm is built up from studying transcription activation almost completely in E. coli. And many groups, including ours, have begun to study transcription regulation in other bacteria like Bacillus, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, other bacteria. And we're finding that the paradigms for polymerase function and also polymerase regulation that have been built up by studying E. coli don't necessarily apply in these other organisms. So this is one example of a mycobacterial transcription activator that luckily for us is also present in thermos, so we're able to study it from a structural point of view. This is that open complex structure that I showed you before, the thermos polymerase bound to the minus 35 and the minus 10 element of the promoter, and the can't see it here, but the template strand is loaded in the active site. Non-template strand goes here. And this CAR-D protein, actually, it doesn't bind DNA. It's not a specific DNA binding protein. It doesn't interact with DNA upstream of the minus 35 element, which would be over here. It actually is known to make a protein-protein interaction with this part of polymerase called the beta 1 lobe. And when we crystallized the complex with CAR-D, we saw that there is indeed a protein-protein interaction with the lobe, as we predicted. But in interacting with the lobe, it positions another part of CAR-D right over the upstream fork of the transcription bubble that you see right here. Here it's double-stranded, here it's single-stranded. And if we look a little closer, you see that this green domain is sort of inserting itself right where the DNA is just starting to melt. There's actually a key residue on CAR-D that's this tryptophan residue. It's not intercalated into the DNA, it's just wedged into the minor groove. It's a very unusual minor groove because this is where the DNA is beginning to melt. Here's a normal minor groove. You can see that this wouldn't fit. But because this is where the transcription bubble is beginning, CAR-D can situate itself in the minor groove. And we think by doing that, it prevents the open complex from re-annealing and dissociating and stabilizes the open complex that way, activates the transcription. So this is working in a way that's very different from this paradigm that I described. Now, from what I've shown you how we've been able to use electron microscopy to get an idea of the shape of the polymerase, more or less. And once X-ray structures became available, we were able to use X-ray combined with EM to combine the two methods to come up with more structural information. But eventually, we went to X-ray crystallography, and we and other groups have been able to determine structures of what I would call sort of stable states of the transcription cycle as you go around. So the core enzyme, hollow enzyme, this open complex is very stable. The elongation complex is very stable. And you know, there's a lot more work to do to understand many functional and regulatory aspects of these states of the transcription cycle. But the real key questions in my mind for studying the transcription cycle, they're sort of moving towards, well, they've always been focused on, but now we're moving towards transitions between these stable states. So the hollow enzyme in DNA, how does it get eventually from double-stranded DNA to this open complex? How does the open complex begin making RNA and get to this state where sigma is released and you have an elongation complex where the nucleic acids are situated very differently than they are here? And once you've encountered a terminator sequence, how does this elongation complex stop transcription, release all the components from this very, very stable complex, and eventually end up with the core enzyme itself? So these are sort of three key transitions that are characterized by sort of very unstable sort of transient intermediates, different states of promoter melting, states of the initial transcription complex where sigma hasn't released but is in the process of releasing, or termination complexes where the polymerase has stopped transcribing and it's releasing DNA and RNA. These are very unstable transient complexes that X-ray crystallography is really poorly suited to getting structures of these kinds of complexes. So now let's talk about X-ray crystallography. As you probably know, we need many MIGs of highly homogeneous stable complexes. This is okay for these stable complexes that I've just described, but for these transient unstable complexes, this is not even possible, I don't think. Then you need to crystallize these things. And so in the end, because of these two requirements, X-ray crystallography produces snapshots of thermodynamically stable states and very poorly suited to transient unstable states. And another problem we have that I mentioned previously is crystal packing. So to illustrate that, I'd like to point out this paper from Richard Ebert's group that used a FRET study to look at the conformation of the clamp domain in RNA polymerase in solution, not in crystals. So in this case, the closed clamp gives rise to high FRET. The open clamp gives rise to low FRET, and they're able to look at the polymerase in solution, the distribution of clamp conformations. And what they see is that in solution under normal conditions, you have a distribution of closed and open clamp states that all collapse into the closed clamp when we have nucleic acids loaded into the active site, which we knew that the clamp closes when nucleic acids are there from crystal structures. But what this means, these distributions of open and closed clamps in solution, is that the transitions between open and closed clamp are very low energy. And so the energy differences between clamp states are small. They're easily overwhelmed by crystal packing forces. And so the conclusion from that is that how can we ever look at these unstable transient intermediates by crystallography when we have these crystal packing forces that are completely overwhelming the conformation of the molecule? So this is a sort of preamble to how we get back into electron microscopy. And I want to sort of point out this paper that came out in 2013. When this paper, we knew sort of stuff was progressing with EM and people were doing higher and higher resolution structures of viruses and also ribosomes and translation complexes. But when this paper came out, it rocked the structural biology world. And what this paper showed is that this was an ion channel solubilized with detergent-like molecules. It's about a 300 kilodalton complex homotetramer. So it's not a particularly large molecule. And using cryo microscopy and single particle averaging, they were able to get about a 3.4 angstrom electron density map that you see here. And they were able to build the structure of the protein without any previous knowledge. So here's an alpha helix, and you see the side chain density. The electron density map was good enough to build the structure from scratch, even though they didn't have any other structures to start with. And this just blew everybody's mind. And so how was it they were able to do this? It's because of two major advances in electron microscopy. The main advance has to do with technological development, and that is new types of detectors. So for many, many years when I was doing electron microscopy, we used film, actually. You collect it on film. You have to take the film out of the EM and expose it in a dark room. And then in order to analyze the images on those films, you have to digitize them. So we have these expensive machines that would digitize the micrographs so that you could do computer analysis of the data. So this was, film is actually a really good substrate for electron microscopy, and you'll see an example of that in a minute. But it was extremely labor intensive to have to collect all these images on film, expose them in the dark room, digitize them. So it was really, really difficult to build up large data sets. So even though CCD cameras were worse in terms of the information that you were able to get from the images, people, eventually almost everyone was using CCDs because of the digital readout, and it's much more quicker and much easier to collect large data sets. So CCDs don't actually detect electrons, they detect photons. So the way CCDs for electron microscopy work is that they had to incorporate a scintillator that converted electrons into photons. When the electrons hit the scintillators, the photons go out in all directions. So the photons here are going out everywhere. And this is called the point spread function. The electron just hits in one spot, but the photons that give rise to the detection of the electron have spread out from the position where the electron is hitting. And these photons that are already spreading out are directed into some fiber optics where there's more noise and a lot of loss of signal. that eventually gets read onto the CCD array. And then for technological reasons that I'm not a camera engineer, the readout of the CCDs is very, very slow. So what you would have to do in the EM is collect an image for say 10 seconds or 15 seconds at a very low exposure, and then you would have to read that image, and the reading would take another sort of several seconds, and then you have to do it again. Now, the new technology that's suitable for electron microscopy are called CMOS, that are actually the things you have in your iPhones, but these were developed to a state where they work for electron microscopy. So these are called direct electron detectors, direct detectors. There's no intermediate step converting the electrons into photons. The electrons are detected directly. So there's no, the point spread function is almost, is insignificant compared to the CCDs. And the other thing is that these CMOS detectors have a very quick readout. So the detectors that we use on EMs now, you can read about 400 frames a second, very fast readout. And this is a very, this is also a critical, one thing is the direct detection gives rise to very high signal to noise, as I'll show you in a minute. But the very fast readout gives rise to another way of improving the structures that I'll also explain. So this shows you an example. This thing is called the DQE, the detector quantum efficiency. This is basically as a function of frequency. You think of this as resolution. So this is low resolution, this is high resolution. And the curves represent the actual information in the image, how much of that information you're getting from the detector. This green line is film, actually not that bad. This is a CCD, pretty terrible. But people still switch to CCDs because of the automation and the digital readout and much more quick. These are the new direct detectors that look like film, more or less. And then there are new modes of using the direct detectors that can work like electron counting machines that give rise to these DQEs that are just, this is why there's this huge advance in cryo-EM, this difference in the DQE here, and the ability to go to much higher resolution and still detect signal. The other thing has to do with the very fast readout, and I'll explain a little bit later why that's really important. So I mentioned crystallography has all these issues. Cryo-EM, especially if you don't have to grow crystals, which we don't have to anymore, you need much less sample. Another key feature is that the sample doesn't have to be homogeneous like it does here, because we don't have to grow crystals. And I mentioned one big advance was the detector technology that I just described a little bit. But another big advance is software analysis. So the software that can analyze the electron images is much more advanced today, and it can deal with heterogeneous samples. We don't need to crystallize, as I mentioned. It's suited for transient unstable states because we can form our state functional states in solution and just freeze them and look at them straight in the electron microscope. We don't have to go through this intermediate step of crystallizing them. And finally, we don't have this issue of crystal packing forces changing the conformation of our molecules. So an example, I'm not going to go through how the software works, but this is just a really, really cool example in the literature studying the ribosome. There's a particular state of the ribosome that no one had ever been able to crystallize. And if you actually form that state and look at it in solution, this is what this group did with millions and millions of particles. And the actual state they were interested in is this one. It's actually only about 2 to 3% of the particles present in their sample. But even though it's only 2% of the sample, they're able to get about a 5 angstrom resolution structure. So this is from the power, not only direct detector to get the structural information, but the software analysis to look at the heterogeneous sample and to sort out the information. So what I'd like to do really quickly at the end here is talk about how we're initially using the cryo-EM and the new technology, and then where we'd like to take it in the near future. So I mentioned the transcription in the cell goes through the initiation process, and it requires additional initiation-specific factors. In the case of bacteria, it's a single polypeptide, the sigma factor. But what I didn't mention is that bacteria have more than one sigma. Most of them are structurally homologous. They bind to the core in the same way, but they recognize different sequences of promoters, and this is one a major way that transcription initiation is controlled. And an interesting thing is that this is work from Akira Ishihama's lab. This is a sort of growth curve of bacteria, the log phase of growth, where the primary sigma 70 is predominant. But as the bacteria use up nutrients, they stop growing and they enter what's called stationary phase. And there's another sigma called sigma 38 or sigma S that the transcription that takes over the transcription program in stationary phase. And it was always thought for years and years that when the bacteria reach stationary phase, sigma 70 must be degraded or go away somehow so that sigma S can take over the transcription program. But when Ishihama's lab actually looked at how much sigma 70 and sigma S was present in the cell, there's always tons of sigma 70 all throughout stationary phase, whereas sigma S isn't really present in log phase and then builds up, but it's much less than sigma 70. So this raised the question, like, how is it possible for sigma S to compete with sigma 70 for the limited amount of core? And the answer, I think, is still not really clear, but a major player in that switch of the transcription program is due to a non-coding RNA that was actually recognized almost 50 years ago. It's a very highly abundant RNA. You grow E. coli to stationary phase, but it was never known what this RNA did. It was the first actually sequenced RNA in history. But it was found in 2000 from this sort of breakthrough paper by Karen Wasserman and Gisela Storz that the 6S RNA is a regulator of transcription. So it binds very efficiently to the sigma 70 holo, and it inhibits sigma 70 dependent transcription. But it doesn't bind or inhibit the sigma S holo enzyme. So the idea is that in stationary phase cells, they make 6S RNA, it binds sigma 70 holo, sequesters it or inactivates it, and that allows sigma S to function. This 6S RNA was known in E. coli, but it turns out it's very widespread and it's found in most bacteria. And it's structurally conserved, not so much conserved in sequence. And you'll notice this is a promoter with the transcription bubble. This is the conserved structural features of the 6S RNA. You'll notice this big central bubble that looks a lot like a transcription bubble. And then these other little bubbles are actually conserved, and I'll explain why in a minute. And another interesting paper a few years later, also from Karen and Ruth Sacker, showed that actually the 6S RNA, if you have a high enough NTP concentration, the polymerase can use 6S RNA as a transcription template. So the DNA-dependent RNA polymerase can use RNA as a template if the nucleotide concentrations are high enough. So the idea is that when the cells reach stationary phase, they make 6S RNA, it binds sigma 70 holoenzyme and sequesters it. When the cells are in stationary phase, they're starving and the nucleotide pools are very low. And so it can't use the 6S RNA as a transcription template. But if the cells escape from stationary phase and start growing again, the NTP pools rise. The cells start making RNA, the RNA polymerase starts making RNA from the RNA template. They make this purple RNA called pRNA, and it causes this conformational switch in the RNA that causes it to release. Now you very quickly have functional sigma 70 holoenzyme. So it's very important for the cells in stationary phase, but it's really important for the cells to escape stationary phase and survive. So the questions are, how does the 6S RNA bind sigma 70 holo and inhibit it? And another really interesting question is, how does it discriminate between these two forms of holoenzyme, because the sigma S and the sigma 70 turn out to be very similar. But maybe I won't talk about that right now. I'm going to skip this. We use footprinting to show that this downstream part of the RNA is not interacting with polymerase, so we made a truncated polymerase. And then what we also did is, you can see that this hybrid and this hybrid have a very similar, the energy between them is not that different. So we think the RNA in solution is alternating between these two states. In order to prevent that and make a more homogeneous complex, what we did is we shuffled the sequence here so that it's no longer complementary, so that we only have one state. Now I'd like to get into why the very quick readout of the direct detector is important. It turns out as soon as you start exposing the sample, the biological sample, to electrons, electron radiation damage starts to occur. And this causes the sample to move, so it's beam-induced sample movement. So if you're using a CCD camera and you have to collect a 10-second exposure, the image, if the image moves a few angstrom during that 10 seconds, then you've completely lost all the high-resolution information that you want. Whereas if you can use a direct detector and have a very high readout, you can take 0.1 or 0.2 second frames. The image, even though it's drifting or moving, it doesn't move that much within that very short time period. So you generate what's called a movie. Then you can take all these frames of the movie and realign them to each other to remove the beam-induced drift. And this is the other key feature that's giving rise to the really high information content of these images. So this is an example from our own work. This is the raw image. All the 50 images in a movie are just combined together, and they give rise to this power spectrum. But if you take all those 50 images and line them up with each other, this gives you an idea of how they're moving. So this is actually, at the beginning of the exposure, they move a lot, and then things settle down and they stop moving. So you just take these images that don't move that much, you add those together, probably difficult for you to see, but these rings go to much higher resolution than they do here. And here is the image, you can see the particles. So this is actually a negative stain image of the 6S RNA. And here's a really cool, you can see the individual particles. And then from these randomly oriented particles, we're able to generate a 3D structure. So this is a reconstruction that has about 100,000 particles in it. It's 4.5 angstrom resolution. What we can do is fit the X-ray structure in. We already have an X-ray structure of E. coli polymerase. Then we can generate a map from the X-ray structure, and you can see extra density that's not accounted for by the X-ray structure. That's obviously the RNA. We generate a difference map. So the green represents the RNA. The dense stuff's not accounted for by the X-ray structure. And what you can see, one thing you can see here in the RNA is that it looks like B-form DNA. There's minor, major grooves. But RNA-RNA duplexes are A-form. They don't really have a major and a minor groove. We think that's the role of these little bulges that allow the RNA to adjust itself so that it looks like B-form DNA and can bind to the holoenzyme that's really a DNA-binding protein. Here we go. This is actually the EM map with the X-ray structure in it, and then the RNA part, the density corresponding to the RNA, is colored in green. There's really, already at 4.5 angstrom, there's a lot of information here, but we think by just collecting more data, maybe if we have a reconstruction with 200,000 instead of 100,000 particles, we think we'll probably be at below 4 angstrom resolution. But already we can see that obviously the RNA is sort of taking up the same form that a DNA, promoter DNA, would take up. So I showed you the old electron microscopy gave rise to the first structural information that we had on RNA polymerase. That told us it was a crab claw, the conformational changes in the clamp domain, and other sort of regulatory features of higher order complexes. But it was really, really difficult to get higher resolution information without going to X-ray crystallography. And that really, after the first X-ray structure, that led to a sort of almost explosion of structural information on hollow enzyme, promoter complexes, elongation complexes, and higher order regulatory complexes that we can do by X-ray crystallography, as I showed. But there's actually very, very few examples of this. It's very, very difficult, as I explained, to assemble these complexes in a homogeneous manner and crystallize them. So this is where we think EM, to assemble higher order complexes and determine their structures. And the second thing, as I explained, is to get transient unstable intermediates in the transitions between the states that we're really, really excited about for the future. So with that, sorry I went on a little longer than I wanted to. I'd like to thank the people in the lab right now, and especially Elizabeth Campbell, who's sort of senior scientist in the lab that keeps everything running smoothly. A lot of the work I described was due to former members of the lab that I've listed here and the positions that they're in at the moment. And we obviously depend on collaborating with a lot of great groups. I'd like to thank Roger Kornberg and Al Edwards, a postdoc in Roger's group, who Al and I worked together as postdocs and did the biochemistry and the structural biology of the Pol-2 at the same time. Paul Landick, Lung Li Lee, who helped us with EM to get started. Arkady Mustaev, I mentioned the cross-linking work. Ramesh on the GP2. People at Rockefeller who run the cryo-EM center, the structural biology center. Richard Hite is a postdoc in Rod McKinnon's lab. He was actually a postdoc in Tom Waltz's lab and is a great source of information on how to do the cryo-EM. And now Tom was at Harvard, now he's moved to Rockefeller. He's also helping us get started with the EM. And we've always utilized these synchrotron beamlines, rely on their support to collect the X-ray data. So thank you very much.
Maybe I can start with a question about, you have slides showing the binding of the different antibiotics to four molecules to the enzyme. So actually, I have a couple questions regarding to this. So you mentioned there's one of the small molecules binding on the bottom of the clamp that will inhibit the clamp motion.
Yeah.
So could you elaborate a bit more, so this will make the clamp always open or closed?
Okay.
How does this work?
So this particular one, mixoperonin, and then there's another one called riprostatin, and another one called corallopurinin. They all bind in the same place, right here, which is the hinge between the clamp domain and the rest of the enzyme. So those three antibiotics, when they bind here, they actually close the clamp.
About the one you recently identified.
So there's another one called lipiromycin that binds close to here, but in a different spot. We don't have a structure of that one, so it's not here. But it actually opens the clamp.
I also show a yellow one, which is bound on top of the hinge. That one is also here with the clamp.
So the clamp is here.
It's not.
This doesn't, as far as we know, it doesn't interfere with clamp motion. It interferes with trigger loop folding. And also, we think, with movements of the bridge helix in ways that we don't understand.
So this unpublished one, this blocks the secondary channel, or is really standing close to the...
Okay.
So do you have an idea of where the band?
Okay, so there's actually two of these. They're called lariat peptides. They have these weird structure. But one is capistrin that we've been able to solve a structure. And another one is microsin J25, and they're completely different. But they both bind in the secondary channel, and not in exactly the same place, but a little bit different. So microsin is definitely blocking the secondary channel. But it's also, by binding here, it's blocking trigger loop folding. So who's to say?
It's binding close to the pore. pore of the...
It's very close to the active site, like right very deep in the pore. So the trigger loop cannot fold when this guy... It's actually interacting with the bridge helix. And it's even if it wasn't blocking nucleoside entry, it would be blocking catalysis.
Yeah, with this figure up here, and in some of your figures, I saw the double-stranded DNA downstream going this way, but shouldn't be going this way, or just a misconception from me. Where the DNA, the downstream double-stranded DNA goes?
So the downstream, the active site is here, the RNA-DNA hybrid is sitting here, and then there's a 90-degree turn, and the downstream DNA would be parallel with the board.
It's parallel like this, instead of sitting like this.
Yeah, yeah. So the RNA-DNA, I see what you're asking now. The RNA-DNA hybrid is like this, but the downstream DNA is...
pointing this way.
Yeah.
So actually, so the DNA, okay, the DNA would bend it by some degrees, so that, okay. Yeah. So polymerase is just like eating the downstream DNA along.
Yeah, the downstream DNA comes in, but then there's about a 90 degree turn between the downstream DNA and the RNA DNA hybrid.
Okay. Another question is on the sigma. You mentioned the sigma factors. We don't have the equivalent of that protein in the eukaryotes.
Right.
But functionally, would it be another protein of the polymerase subunit, a subunit of the polymerase, of eukaryotic polymerase, that performs similar function to sigma factor?
So, definitely. So, for I can only speak about Pol II, where the most is known about the GTFs, or the general transcription factors. So the role, one role of sigma is to go into the active site and block elongation of the RNA, and that role seems to be filled by TF2B. Another role of sigma is to initially recruit polymerase to the promoter before it's melted, and that's probably done by TBP and in combination with TF2B. But then the role of sigma in generating the transcription bubble, there isn't really... I don't know what the analogy would be, because we don't know in the eukaryotic system how the bubble is made, really.
And what about the one that blocked the exits of the new RNA?
That would be TF2B. So TF2B has this reader and or finger, whatever you want to call it, that goes in, out, kind of like the sigma. So in order for the RNA-DNA hybrid to form, that has to be displaced, yeah.
Okay. I think so. Maybe let's thank Professor Darst again for his wonderful talk.